Hello, welcome to this Laker lesson, Research into Action, Pandemic Recovery and Education, the Best Evidence. If you've watched other Research into Action Laker lessons, you know this is a series where we share the best evidence and the best research with you, a busy educator, a busy practitioner, in a short presentation so that you can get that evidence without having to go find it yourself. I'm Venessa Keesler, and I've partnered with the Grand Valley Charter Schools Office to bring you today's Laker lesson. Before we jump into the content about pandemic recovery and education, we always start these Laker lessons with three things to remember about research. So if you've watched other Research into Action, you've seen me do this before. So three things to remember. There's good research, and then there's junk research. Research summary, a bunch of research only shows associations, not cause and effect. And research is science, so it's always evolving. I'm going to unpack these briefly. Not everything that you see out there that's called research is high quality. We've all seen somebody say, well, I looked at the research and it says this. And when you go look at what they looked at, it really wasn't super high quality research. The good news for all of you is if you're watching these Research into Action Laker lessons, you are getting good research. That's what I'm doing, is reviewing the research for some quality standards. So when I bring it to you, it's good. So you don't have to worry about it yourself. But if you are out in the world and you're trying to evaluate the quality of some evidence that someone has brought forward, here's a couple things to think about. You want to look for research that's been in a peer-reviewed journal. That means the author of it has submitted it to a journal and other scientists have read it, reviewed the methods, the findings, given feedback. And so when it's published, it's been validated by more than just the author. You want to make sure that there's a description of methods. What data did they use? How did they analyze them? What were their assumptions? And you want to avoid self-published research by advocacy organizations. So there are a number of organizations that say, we did our own research and we found that our position is correct. While there might be good data and good evidence in those, it's not quite the same as high quality research that's been validated by a third party. Or sometimes companies say, well, we studied our product and we found out it is the best product. You can see obviously why that might be a little biased. And just because the research is packaged up in a slick graphics with a picture of a child who looks really happy to be learning doesn't mean it's actually good research. Something that's really challenging in education is the difference between associations and cause and effect. So one of the most common things we hear in education is, well, what works? We want to know what works, and then we're going to do what works and we'll see the outcome we expected. Unfortunately, establishing what works, as in one thing caused another, is challenging. It's challenging in all science, and it's especially challenging in education because you have to be able to test the intervention, the thing you're trying to implement to improve some outcome, using certain methods that are sometimes hard to implement in education. A lot of research in education is actually about associations or correlations. After we implemented this program, we saw that teachers were happier or students performed better. And while those things might very well be related, sometimes there might be something else impacting that change. You want to make sure if the study is using appropriate methods for cause and effect or if they're using correlation methods. The old saying is correlation does not equal causation. So just because two things are related doesn't mean one caused the other. At the same time, research is science, and education research is science. So it's always evolving, and sometimes we have to use our best methods or our best information to make informed decisions. So if all you have available to you is some correlational studies that suggest that doing this practice or implementing this program might work, that's probably better than no evidence at all. Don't be surprised when the evidence emerges, changes, is more complicated. That's why I encourage you to keep watching these Research into Action Laker lessons, because we are bringing you the most recent research. So people are studying things in education and they have new findings. They test new hypotheses and they bring new information to the table. It can be discouraging sometimes because you think, oh, it's always changing. Well, I don't even know what to do. But that's the process of science. That's what helps us get better at our practice together. Before we get into the overall research on pandemic recovery, I wanted to take a minute and share some findings from the GVSU Charter School portfolio. So four charter schools in the GVSU portfolio, the achievement gains made in math and reading in 2022 outpaced the achievement gains made in 2021. The fall to spring achievement gains made across most grade levels in the past year parallel achievement gains made prior to the pandemic. So there is some initial evidence for the GVSU charter schools that there is academic rebounding following the pandemic. However, even though there's evidence for some of this academic rebounding, students' achievement in the spring of 2022 still remains lower compared to the pre-pandemic period, with larger declines in math as compared to reading. And this echoes what we're seeing nationwide in general. While academic scores are coming back, that there's still not where we were pre-pandemic, and there's still work to be done, both in academics and non-academics, to support students and their outcomes. You are lucky because Grand Valley Charter School Office does research or partners with researchers to do research and makes it available to you. That's where those findings that I just shared came from. So you are able to access high-quality research provided by the Charter School Office, and you can do so here, gvsu.edu/CSO/research. So keep an eye on that page for research that's really pertinent to you and your day-to-day lives, because it's on the charter school portfolio. So what else are you going to learn today? We're going to talk about some key instructional strategies that are showing the most promising evidence in pandemic recovery. We're going to talk about some school-wide practices that can support learning recovery and some recommended extended learning time practices. I would note that the pandemic is still happening and the lockdowns and things like that are not that long ago. So this is really new research. And that means that it's going to be, the science around this is going to keep changing. You remember I said research is science and it evolves. This is one area where we're so close to the event just happening. The data are just starting to come out. So it definitely represents an ongoing research-informed conversation. And I wanted to point you at a really great resource. So the Annenberg Institute at Brown University devotes a whole initiative getting the best empirical evidence related to pandemic recovery out to everybody. And it also has a lot of good empirical evidence about education as a whole. So you can sign up for their newsletter at this website, annenberg.brown.edu/recovery. And today I'm using two resources from Annenberg pretty heavily, and those will be linked in your live binder that's going to be posted along with this Laker lesson with Works Cited and these resources. So there's a brief on broad-based academic supports for all students and school practices to address student learning loss. Before we get into it, I just wanted to make a note on terms. There is a lot of conversation about how do we talk about what happened, the impacts of the pandemic, academic, social, emotional. Terms like learning loss are not always appreciated by educators. They're debated. Is it learning loss? What does that mean? For this Laker lesson, I'm just using the term pandemic recovery broadly to encompass research on strategies that can be used in schools to support students and teachers after the school closures and other challenges related to the pandemic. I'm just noting that there are debates about how we talk about this. So what are some key instructional strategies in pandemic recovery? You may be tired of hearing this, but it turns out that multi-tiered systems of support are important in pandemic recovery, just like they're important in education all the time. So we know that strong tier one instruction and supports, those things that all students get, are critical in education in general, and they remain important in pandemic recovery. You can't intervene your way out of the impacts of the pandemic. In addition to your strong tier one supports, utilizing those targeted and intensive interventions for students and thinking about students most impacted by the pandemic. So I know that that's probably what most of you have been doing, right? This is in our first school year where we're trying to remediate from the impacts of the pandemic, but the research continues to say that's what's important. So thinking about how to target interventions for students and deliver them just in time. Speaking of just in time, that's how the research suggests that grade levels should be delivered as well. So rather than repeating material that was missed, teaching grade level material with just-in-time review. What research, cognitive learning research in general, shows is that when you build skills that students lack at the time those skills are relevant for their learning, that's more impactful than generally saying, let's learn this skill, and then they don't do anything with it for 3 months, the curriculum catches up, and then you say, remember that skill we learned back in August? Like, we need to do it now. And as always, using your formative assessment practices in your classrooms. And school leaders supporting your teachers in using those formative assessment practices. That gives you that short cycle, curricular-based feedback on what students are learning, what they're struggling with, and where they need that additional just-in-time review. Create time for teacher collaboration. If you watched the Research into Action on Professional Learning and Instructional Coaching, we talked a lot about teacher collaboration in that one, and if you haven't, maybe you'd like to view that one. Teacher collaboration is really important in pandemic recovery as well. Time for teachers to collaborate is key, and the research is unified on the importance of this. They need time to collaborate around the assessments that they're doing, the formative assessment. They need time to collaborate around instructional strategies, and they need time to collaborate around the curriculum. And they also need to be able to troubleshoot and identify joint solutions. Here's a few strategies to avoid: an over-reliance on standardized testing in lieu of teacher-driven formative assessments. Now, I have a long background in a large-scale assessment, and I know that how and when we give state-required assessments is not usually in the control of you as an individual teacher or leader, and the debate over standardized assessments is political and a whole different situation. But from the research, while standardized testing will happen and you should look at those data and that's just going to be part of the landscape, teacher-driven formative assessments are going to be more important for pandemic recovery. They're going to help you more, according to research, be able to provide students with what they need in terms of instruction and other supports. You should avoid remediation students that pull students out from regular instruction and put them somewhere else. So again, that removes them from those strong tier one supports, and it's not supported by research. You should avoid teaching extra content without changing the degree to which students are getting extra support. So when double dose courses in algebra or things like that are shown not to be as effective if there isn't additional support for students getting that extra content. And then again, this is a political issue often, but grade retention on a large scale without substantial additional support is not supported by research. So while the politics can debate about it, the research is pretty clear on this point. So what are some second point we want to talk about? Some school-wide practices that support pandemic recovery. And here's my asterisk. As I prepared this, I thought, well, a lot of these are just really great practices that we should think about regardless. They are probably really good ideas for education in general. The first, and we've all heard this, but I just want to tell you the research continues to support it, creating an environment that supports strong teacher-student relationships is key. And I think we've all heard this fact stated, but I'll state it one more time. Students who have at least one stable and committed relationship with a supportive adult are more likely to respond to adversity and succeed. And that's why all of you out there who are teachers and school leaders, that time you spend getting to know kids and caring about them and supporting them in their work, that is never lost time. That is really important. This is a strong finding in the research, and thank you for doing the work that you do. And it's not just individual relationships, it's the overall school environment. So creating stability at the school level helps diminish learning loss. And this comes out of research that people did around Hurricane Katrina or other traumatic situations. I do want to note, though, that supportive relationships don't just happen. I get a little concerned when we say that statement about a supportive relationship with an adult without remembering that teachers need help to be a supportive adult. So we want to move out of this idea of teacher is hero. Like if only the teacher supports enough kids, everything will be okay. We want to help set teachers up for success, and we want structures in place to support students in addition to these individual relationships. This means teachers need time to build supportive relationships with students. They need professional learning on key relationship building strategies. And they need time for teacher collaboration. We already talked about teacher collaboration for pandemic recovery, but it's important in this space as well with supportive relationships. How are you building relationships with kids? What works and what doesn't? What's really maybe not a good idea in terms of relationship building? Who have you formed relationships with? Who doesn't seem to have a supportive relationship? All of those things that teachers can collaborate around is critical. Second piece of advice is to take a look at school logistics. So there's been research on this outside of the pandemic, but students lose between 10 and 20 days of instructional time over the course of a school year, about 3 to 6 minutes of lost time each hour due to things like interruptions, announcements, knocks at the door, whatever. So people raised this finding up, researchers raised this finding up after the pandemic to say, time is even more precious. We can't lose it now. We really need these days back. But I think this is one of those things in general where reducing interruptions in any school year, pandemic recovery or not, would support student learning. And small changes to logistics that minimize classroom instruction could have a big impact. So here's what the research suggests, as well as me personally, asking teachers to identify and track interruptions in their day. So doing some sort of time study or get a group of teachers together and say, what interrupts you? When does it interrupt and how? And then brainstorm ways to limit those interruptions or to structure them differently. Some things people have tried is instead of announcements at random times, only one time a day, limiting the use of the intercom, reducing classroom visits, reducing calls to classroom phones. Essentially, whatever your teachers say is disrupting our instructional time, find a solution to make that easier. You'll get time back, you'll have teachers and students more focused on instruction, and everybody will feel a lot more positive because nobody likes to be interrupted in the middle of something. Tutoring is another really important part of pandemic recovery. There is a lot of evidence around high dosage tutoring based on classroom content. We are going to do a separate Laker lesson unpacking research-based components of tutoring for pandemic recovery and accelerated learning. And again, I think that that is important for the pandemic conversation, but also for tutoring in general. But I did want to name in this that tutoring is a research-supported strategy for pandemic recovery. And let's talk a little bit about extended learning time. There's a couple extended learning time options. There's several. And all of these are recommended by research, and they're things that were happening before the pandemic, but that have particular applicability after the pandemic as options to help students catch up or students advance to where they need to go. One option is week-long acceleration academies. These need to be staffed by highly effective teachers. When these have been done before, they're delivered during week-long vacation breaks. So remember, we don't want to pull students out of their core instruction to do remediation. So rather, the schools that have done this, they've inverted that. They have the kids come in on breaks, they hire highly effective teachers, they put students in small groups with similar ability grouping, and they give them additional instruction. And that has been a positive in terms of academic outcomes. And then I already mentioned double dose math classes, but in Chicago, they use double dose math classes with that additional support and saw good outcomes for students. So they had ninth graders with low math test scores who were enrolled in algebra and an algebra support class. And then the teachers got professional development in using that extra instructional time. And a final strategy around extended learning time is summer learning programs. So these are things that were occurring before the pandemic. You probably implemented one last summer, but the research does show that they're helpful, and the research also suggests some key components. So that's what I'd like to talk about right now. Summer learning programs should be at least 5 weeks and at least 3 hours of academic instruction. Class size ideally is less than 15 students per teacher. Attendance is important. Kids need to attend these programs. So to help with that, programs should communicate the importance of high attendance at the beginning when recruiting students to parents, guardians, supportive adults, and to the kids themselves, and then create an engaging site climate so kids want to attend. There should be positive relationships with adults. There should be engaging material and activities. And that leads me to the fourth recommendation, to include enrichment activities in the summer program. So including those alongside academics helps expose students to other kinds of opportunities and reinforces attendance and engagement. And then finally, curriculum. A summer learning program should use high quality curriculum materials that include lesson plans that are aligned with standards and other materials. It is not best practice, according to research, to ask teachers to plan their own lessons in the summer because it's a relatively short amount of time for development and implementation. And you see all of these recommendations come from that brief I spoke about at the beginning that McCombs and Augustine made in 2021. And that is linked in the live binder for you to review on your own. Thank you for taking time out of your day to view this Laker lesson. I hope you learned something about pandemic recovery and the key research on it. If you want to dig into any of the citations, like I said before, they are provided in the live binder and they include the works cited and the briefs that were referenced today. Have a great day.